felt so oppressed.
You think that's going to happen?
It's not going to happen because they're not going to want to go talk to the dean about it. So, you know, just think about why we've gone this way of almost making each other scary, which I think is what the debate on the street was about, and what, in a weird way, 50 Shades of Grey is a compensation. It's like, well, you know, you're the bad girl, but he'll ultimately marry you. And when he marries you, he's going to become monogamous. Yeah, right. You know, I mean, it's like total fantasy. But it's a fantasy that has overwhelming power. And so I just think we need to, the whole beginning of emphasizing action, collectivity, sharing, that's what consciousness raising was about. And the example of Harlem Hospital is men's misbehavior needs to be corrected, but it doesn't need to be individualized and separated out. It needs to be diagnosed.
Can I just ask one more question, because we soon have to leave the classroom. Also, you know, to relate it to the text itself that we have read. This proposal of zoning, right? Do you think that it's, on one hand, I really like the idea of protecting the imaginary domain and constructing the imaginary domain in such a way that you can choose when you want to be exposed to certain images or not. But is it still feasible now that their images are everywhere?
At the time, remember, I'm dealing with an industry that had CD sites where they were sold.
Right.
Zoning seemed plausible to say that this is where porn would be sold if people did not want to have it in their face. I think that's part of the book that may be outdated because we don't have CD stores anymore. So I'd have to really rethink how you protect your imaginary domain. I mean, even Glamour magazine is about sex. And this debate about collective action versus non-collective action in terms of sexual harassment, even that's been going on for a long time. I mean, women have the right to have their imaginary domain and be students and not be infringed upon by male professors. That goes without saying. But I do think that we need to think about why we turn to law and accusations rather than confrontation and direct action. That's what's called for. And sometimes even amongst young people themselves, the misreadings. Do you really want to get another student in trouble and kicked out of school? Or do you want to diagnose this as a much deeper problem, which is what I think the class is about. Earlier on, and then I know we have to go, there were debates about date rape, and I debated a young woman named Kate Brophy who said that all people had date rape and feminists were just proved. You see, I never had date rape, and maybe I can leave you with my grandmother's advice. When I was 16, my grandmother said to me, you may start dating boys. So I'm just going to give you three pieces of advice. When you're with a boy, say the following jingle. They'll hug you, and they'll kiss you, and they'll tell you more lies than there's hair on your head, dear, and stars in the sky. She thought I was going to be heterosexual. The second thing is, you never go into any enclosed space with a boy, any, unless you're about ready to marry him, which was, for her, meaning really enclosed with that boy. And secondly, that includes cars. Cars are particularly dangerous. So I just got my driver's license, so I said, well, how am I going to do that? She said, well, this is my contribution. I bought you a car. So unlike Kate Bouncy, I never had any trouble with date rape. She did tell me, though, if I left the boy in a movie theater because I was trying to watch the movie and he was trying to do something else, I had to leave him a dime so he could call his mother. And I remember once I got halfway to my grandmother's house, and I forgot to leave the dime, so I had to drive all the way back. The boy was still thinking I was coming back. I just appeared in time, caught him up. This worked like a charm for me in terms of avoiding date rape. But notice the other thing is never let men pay for you. And because they'll think they're paying for one thing, and you'll think you're paying for another. My grandmother raised me to think the whole thing was independence. I picked the boys up, I had the car, I paid my own way. And that was her whole basic lesson. Be independent, be in control of your immediate environment. And you now look at like some of these cases where students are suing each other. The most tragic one to me being two students who were blacked out. Both saying, one the woman saying that she got date raped, him saying he was blacked out, but she was blacked out, so nobody can remember. And now this is like a big lawsuit with all the parents involved. But I see, my grandmother would tell you, it's a very bad idea if you're blacked out to go into an enclosed space with a boy who's also blacked out. So in a certain sense, the lesson that's against 50 Shades of Rape is independence. Stay independent. And that goes for boys too. And then you can figure out how to read what you want to do within a stage that you've set of independence. Finally, one of my best friends was dropped off in Harlem, which is about time to say this very scary. The bio boy said, have sex with me or I'm going to put you out in the corner. And she said, I should have flipped and to Mrs. Kellogg, and this never would have happened because I would have had the car. And I think, you know, when we're looking now at these fraught scenes between young people, one of the messages that gets dropped out is independence. You know, to the degree, and this isn't a big argument for autonomy in the philosophical sense, just some understanding that you want to be in control of your immediate staging of your environment. And I felt that's what both sides, the yes say yes and no means no, and the Tinder people were losing, is they were staging their own sexuality in a way that was fraught with misunderstanding.
Thank you very much. What's
skinniness? It's like a little boy with some giant boobs. Look at Barbie. I mean, the boobs aren't real. They're not food anymore. You use breasts as food. They don't stand out so that you can use them to put your Diet Coke on if you have to rest for a minute. So that comes again and again into the pornography scene, which is why it's so much about domination. McKinnon was not exaggerating about the violence of so much of pornography, and that violence was actually enacted on bodies. It was, what does one do about it? Not whether or not that violence existed. So when you look at that scene then, ultimately, on the psychoanalytic level, I would never say that pornography or prostitution is a liberatory practice, nor would I see. Certainly not under conditions of advanced capitalism. And if we didn't have advanced capitalism, would there be something called sex work? The brothel story I told you is very important. You can't just take a violent scene and turn it into work. That's what happens when you're up against the pimps. The pimps have guns. They come at you with guns. You can try to do armed self-defense, but without the support of the police and the state, you can't really run a collective brothel. So we can call it sex work, but if it's in this scene of violence, it's very difficult to do. That doesn't mean that I'm still not for decriminalization and unionization. As it's only within the side of decriminalization that you can actually go after corrupt police. As long as you keep it an underground scene, you can't symbolize it. At So the whole underground scene gets associated psychoanalytically with the maternal body. And in this way, I agree with McKinley that that scene is one of domination. And it's not a scene of freedom by definition, because the young person is not choosing in any of the meanings of the word choice how they're going to have sex. That is set up for them by whoever is the director, and the director, of course, is somebody at that time in the porn industry. With the internet, and I should say I'm a real lot, so I don't know exactly all the complexities of internet sex, and I don't pretend to. You no longer have those sites of the underground, although you still obviously have the capacity to connect to quote-unquote real, not virtual, women, although the distinction may have been blurred considerably. So I just wanted to end by saying that in this chapter, I actually agree with a lot of what McKinley says about the actual scene that I was writing about, given the psychoanalytic underpinnings of the repressed, scary maternal body. Violence is almost inevitably part of that scene. So the dispute with McKinnon was really about what do you do about it? And in a certain way, when you unionize and decriminalize and you have a campaign like all condom sets and you bring the question of AIDS to the foreground, you're bringing things into the symbolized light of day. You're taking it out of that repressed, scary maternal body and saying, this is what is really going on in these porn sets. So you give a symbolic aspect to what makes porn movies sexy, which is the endless repetition of this scene that can never actually be, or should not be, or must be, according to Freud, repressed at the level of day-to-day life. So for Freud, you always need these outlets because, right, once you marry, and marriage for Freud is key because, remember, that's why you can't have socialism. He always saw it as a community of women rather than the end of private property. I mean, obviously, if you nationalize the gold mines in South Africa, does that mean that all women are going to belong to all men? I don't think there's any logical link. But Freud saw there was a logical link. Because for him, what happens when you marry, right, is you carve out this little place where you accept in a certain way, like the dire unhappiness of being basically a castrated guy. It's kind of, this probably is before your time, Walter Mitty, you know, a civil servant, you get up in the morning at 9 to 5, you have sex with your wife on Saturday night for 10 minutes, and then you go to your prostitute maybe once a month and enact your darker fantasy. So you need prostitution in Freud. But basically you live here. And for him, socialism was bursting through that little boxed-in area, which is why he thought that socialism would bring about chaos, something he started to change at the end of his life after the Nazis. So even though it's a happy story for men, it's not a particularly happy story. The average hours of work in a law firm in New York City is now 79 hours a week. That's billable hours, probably putting in about 80, 89 hours. So, you know, you come home, I don't know, when you do come home, most law firms in New York have showers and beds, so we don't have to crowd. When you do come home, you're pretty tired, right? Maybe you get to come home like a couple hours on Sunday afternoon. Why do men or women, but women drop out in much larger numbers, accept that? Is that a great life? Suppose you make a lot of money, but then if you break it down to how many hours you work, you make less than a McDonald's worker. I mean, so you see, Freud's point is to be in capitalism, we got to really keep our men marching along with the program. And how do you do that? You threaten to castrate them all the time. So, you know, what happens to you if you don't work those hours? You say, Pete has a soccer game.
the big boss comes down and says, "You're so bad for Freud." To keep men civilized also means to keep them, if you will, extremely boxed in. As you know, the story for women is much grimmer because our only primary identification. So for us too, the maternal body becomes other to ourselves. That's what the debate about abortion is about. If women can actually, quote unquote, imagine how they want to engage in their own reproductive power, then that whole maternal scene comes into the light of day. That's terrifying. I mean, that women could just do what they want with their own uterus. I mean, it's like explodes everything. So you have to keep women from having any of that power. It has nothing to do with fetuses or babies. It was an interview with Right to Lifers. None of them would even consider adopting children because, given their views, right? They only wanted children that came from bare sperm. And what's an adopted child? An adopted child is by definition like the sperm, so you want to have one of those. That's where you know that you're a man, is that your sperm is in a little boy and it's penis. So for women, the only thing we can have, this is the Electra complex, is we also repress that maternal thing. So the only thing we can identify with is what makes us attractive to men. And this is why, of course, for Freud and for Lacan, older women hate younger women. And you're just our displacement. That's all we have, right, is our stand-up boobs and our skinny bodies, and we babify. But we can't be a babe anymore. We're just mad at the babes. So we hate them. And this is why, of course, for Lacan and Freud, women say such hateful things like, "You didn't realize that!" Or "You should go to the gym." Or "I hate your lipstick." Or whatever. The only thing that a woman can do to resolve her electric conflict, since she hates other women, particularly the babes, is to have a boy who has a penis. And then, even though it's not her penis, she can identify with the boy and the penis. Therefore, of course, women prefer their male sons over their female daughters, who are just competition. Who wants to live in this civilization? I certainly don't. But this is the basic scene of civilization. And this is, plays out in pornography. So in that way, I think it's very relevant in this class that psychoanalysis helps us comprehend what's actually going on in that scene. So I think I'm going to stop there and open it up for questions.
Thank you. That was great. I would have tons of questions, but let's see whether somebody else wants to begin.
I'm curious about whether you think there is genuine ownership in the porn industry for females. Because I know that you mentioned that you think that there's individual agency for the female body, but like because the porn industry can be so coercive for women and so violent, do you think that there is like genuine ownership that
is there ownership?
Genuine ownership.
Yeah.
Is there genuine ownership?
Do you think that she can...
If I understand you correctly, you think that there may be agency, like the case of the porn stars, but maybe not genuine ownership.
Not ownership. You see, remember, I'm a socialist, so I'm a 100% socialist, so I'm not big on owning things, period. So the idea of the collective brothel was that by socializing the means of production, we could begin to break into the violent way in which sex was utterly controlled by masculine fantasy. And I think actually that kind of worked. You know, you have to check off what kind of sex act you're going to have. There's a lot of discussion about the phrase blowjobs. I was a blowtorch operator, and since I didn't have any sex education growing up, when I first heard the phrase, I actually, from some boy, I actually thought that the person meant a blowtorch job. And, why would anybody want a 450 Fahrenheit blowtorch directed at their male organs? It's a god. It would be a really painful job. So we actually outlawed blowjobs. Because a blowjob, the way it was given, was seen as a software form of after being, you know, debated, I suppose, in any given collectively run brothel. The idea was that if those, we think of something like blow job. I mean, why is a job associated with sex? Really, when you think about it. I mean, maybe it is about blow torture. I mean, it just, we took every single aspect of sexuality and discussed it. You know, we were young. I admit, we were very young and very idealistic. This whole thing is pretty idealistic. But we held on for 10 months. So, did we facilitate agency knowing that we weren't going to stop the... we weren't going to stop prostitution in its track. This dates this whole discussion until we'd seize state power, which we intended to do. As you probably know, Fidel Castro ended prostitution. It's coming back now, of course, but he ended it and it stayed ended for 30 years. And what happened was all the prostitutes were given whatever they wanted to do, paid for by the state. Teacher, doctor, nurse, artist, actress, you name it. But, and guess what? Nobody said, I want to be a prostitute. You know, everybody chose the retraining program. So it wasn't like there were some prostitutes saying, no, I don't want to be a doctor, I really want to be a prostitute. You didn't get any protest. So I think in that sense, I still, you know, this was the reform revolution debate that was so big in that time. So this was our reform program. And once we seized state power, we would end prostitution. I'm still inclined to think that there would be no prostitution if we had a just socialist society. I'm still inclined to think that. I know there's others who would disagree with me, and I think honestly Weekers would agree there would be no prostitution. And no paid-for porn sets. That doesn't mean there wouldn't be fantasy scenes you couldn't put together on the internet, but they wouldn't have this very frozen, repetitive form based on the psychoanalytic repression of the woman's body. There'd be something very different. And obviously, under the imaginary domain, it's not meant to be repressive about people's sexual fantasies, but it is meant to make people reflect on what they are, because they're not yours. I think that's your point about ownership more broadly. They're not your fantasies. They're just this enactment of the repression of the eternal body. They are, in a certain sense, imposed fantasies, given how sexual difference has been symbolically limited.
Maybe if I can just add something to this, because I was very fascinated by we engage with the idea, is pornography, like in a mainstream heterosexual pornography, by definition sadomasochistic, and always sadomasochistic. And because I've been thinking recently, I'm in this weird position that I've been coming from a different imaginary, Italian one, I somehow see things here in the U.S. as a stranger, although, I mean, we are all now somehow in this global village. But, like, for instance, in the case of pornography, I remember, you know, when I was a teenager, pornography was still, CDs, and so it was really limited. On top of it, I came from a place on the seaside, so the naked body was there all the time, which made pornography not that interesting anyway. So I was not, I didn't grow up into it somehow. And what I found shocking when I moved to the States and in New York was the everywhere presence of sadomasochistic imaginary, like in the dressing, in the way people walked around, up to the point where you know, 50 Shades of Grey came, and everybody on the tube was reading it, and everybody said, what do you think about this book? And I was like, okay, what is this book about? And then, you know, like, I didn't manage to read the books also because, I mean, like, there were three big volumes, like, I don't have the time for it, but at some point I said, okay, I watched the movie. And if you watch the movie, what you see is, and I don't know what you think about it, but what you see is that what is fascinating there is precisely the fact that the gender roles are so exaggerated. The man buys and pays for everything, right? And this is what somehow, I don't know, but I have the impression that it nourishes the fantasy that there are, you know, still men who are going to take care of you. Right. That's why I saw this documentary afterwards, which was about explaining the success of Shades of Grey. All these women, you know, going. It's not a man success. 50 Shades of Grey is a women thing. So somehow the idea that there are still men who are gonna do it. They're gonna give me a car when I graduate as a present. They're gonna pay for all of our dinners out. Is somehow reassuring for, you know, in terms of. Precisely because gender roles are now being reshuffled, this kind of sadomasochistic culture is a exaggerated compensation for our anxieties and fears.
I also saw the movie with my daughter, who's a line student, and a bunch of her friends. And, you know, again, you have the psychoanalytic scene because it's the good girl who succumbs, right? Who wants to be entered in to the world, the bad girl. And, you know, I just saw a debate on the street. I was walking with a writer friend of mine, not a debate, a screaming match between the no means no group who basically say that you only can have sex if you have written consent. Sometimes notarized written consent. And then I forget what the link is. There's some link where you just go on to have sex.
Okay, no, I don't know.
Ashley Madison?
What's it called?
Ashley Madison?
I forgot the name of the link. There's a link that you go on and you just. I don't.
Tinder, Bumble?
Grindr.
Tinder.
Yeah, that's
Tinder.
It. Okay, so there were Tinder girls waiting for boys, and the yes say yes, or yes means yes, or no means no, or whatever that group of. And they were just sitting on the street screaming at each other. It was freezing cold, the girls were wearing very short skirts and really, really high shoes, and the yes say no means no, or whatever, and they were just yelling at each other. You're a slut, you're repressed, you're a slut, you're repressed. So I decided with my friend that we bring Hegel into the debate, which wasn't a huge success. But I am in agreement with you that what's happened now in heterosexuality is, in particular, is total confusion.
Right.
And that signs are very hard to read anymore. So, I mean, you really want to go to a notary, but what my point was, dialectically, they're both parts of neoliberal capitalism. On the one part, you know, you commodify yourself and sell yourself to the highest bidder because the Tinder people were saying they were going to get paid for going out to dinner, and then they would have sex. So that's 50 Shades of Grey. The yes said, well, you know, we're going to get contracts. But turning everything into a contract is neoliberal capitalism, right? A long notarized contract. So I was trying to say, this is what neoliberal capitalism has done to you. I agree with you that the way that I feel a lot of young women, and I have a 23-year-old daughter who goes to land, is that women still make a lot less than men. It's a very, very scary world. Unemployment is very high. The opportunities for young people are very small. The amount of debt that you've incurred by the time you get out of college is very high. And in that threatening world, the image is not only of, you know, the, because the phallic mother is always the bad girl. That's what the Tinder girls are enacting. Now, they're almost falling over because their heels are so high. So probably a little smaller heel would be better to enact the bad girl. But that they're the bad girls, right? And then the good girls are, you know, we're only going to have sex with notarized documents. The way in which people are unable to read sexual difference leads to the fact that that book was on the bestseller list for years, and the movie was one of the all-time box office hits. Now, this is, tells us a lot about the world in which we lived in. And earlier on, and now we have Title IX and sexual harassment, what makes people feel that going to law, now, you know, I'm a lawyer, I'm not saying that, but note that this whole discussion has been direct action is much more effective than law most of the time. What makes people go to law if they're in trouble? Now, I know that sexual harassment is a real problem, and a lot of professors are really out of control. Now, why don't people think about direct action? And I'll give you an example from our consciousness raising group. We had a man who didn't pay his child care payments. We did not put him in jail or file a lawsuit against him or make him go further in debt. So what did we do? We passed out leaflets in front of Harlem Hospital where he worked and said, sisters and brothers, we got a problem here. This woman's got three kids and this asshole isn't paying his child care payments. And we'd like your help. We don't want to put him in jail. We don't even want to bring a lawsuit against him, get him in debt. He's a brother, an asshole brother, but a brother. And we'd like you to just express your concern. They expressed their concern. You know, he got stink bombs, his tires slashed, he actually had a car. He was harassed day in and day out until his three kids were 18. He paid his child care payment. So you got a guy, right? And there's a professor pulling down his pants or whatever. Why not direct action? Why not surround him in the elevator and say, hey, you want to see it? I mean, come on, why not? Why not? Why don't we go into that mode? What's the point of bringing individual lawsuits? This is a collective problem if men are misbehaving. I'll go with you. I'd be happy to surround a man in an elevator and say, hey, well, you want to see it? You know, come on, let's do it. This is what you want? You know, I mean, why? Why don't we think that way? Because it will be infinitely more effective. I guarantee you that man will keep his hand off his student's breath if that's what took place. A sexual harassment lawsuit is a long, individualized battle. I really want you to think about this. I mean, and I'm not denying that it's a serious problem. There are no woman who hasn't gone through it. You know, I remember being a freshman in college and having a man drop his pants and asking for that famous blowtorch. And I was like stunned. Now, so, you know, we've all gone through it. It's horrible. It shouldn't be silenced. It should be shared, but if it's a problem, let's go after it together. Because I think that's much more effective, but it also makes the point that women can stand up for themselves. There is always something about an individualized lawsuit. Now, and I'm not against law, and I'm certainly for a constitution, and I'm for the rule of law. That individualized lawsuits take a long time, and they're always going to be about you and the individual. Most of the time, I'm going to argue for collective action. And I really think we could do so much better with a little collective action with these sexual harassers. Because if you do it to them once, and they're never going to want to happen again. And what are they going to go to the dean and say? Well, okay, so I've been fiddling with women's breasts. And then a bunch of them got in the elevator and said, you want to see them?
And they started to like say, come on, you want to feel it? And, you know, you think he's going to do that? And they said, okay.
The ground, find out what was going on there.
And pay my dues.
Go to the sites with honesty and show that, you know, I was willing to get behind her union with my body, which is, in my opinion, what all of us should have been doing, because that's where something was really happening. Not in the Harvard Law Review, not in the New York Times reporting how women hate each other, but with a woman who was really saving lives and saying that as long as this industry existed, it should be decriminalized and organized, and workers should be treated with decency and dignity. Now, the imaginary domain comes into this idea with another very fraught discussion, which is the discussion of whether or not there was such a thing as woman. There was a famous book, probably, I don't know if you signed it in the class, I think you did. Judith Butler wrote a book called Gender Trouble, which begins the first sentence saying that feminism doesn't need the category of woman. Then there were people like Lucia and Rye who were saying we certainly need to comprehend the feminine within sexual difference, not just as the objective other, but without some kind of affirmation of the feminine within sexual difference. All you do is return to the privileging of the masculine in a false form of neutrality that simply is not yet actualized. In fact, that you can make statements about who and what women are. And then, of course, there's a famous book by Carol Gilligan, which associates, she's misread on this, associates women or feminine sexual difference with a different way of thinking about morality and ethics. And there's also Sally Reddick's book, who taught at Eugene Lang for many, many years, about maternal ethics. The debate became essentialist, non-essentialist. And the non-essentialist position is that there's basically nothing that can be said about woman, because it's Butler's argument is that whenever you perform woman, you perform it within the structures of heteronormativity. Again, this debate became very fractured. You were on one side or you were on the other. In this debate, I tried to come up with a way of thinking about it differently so that we could find alliances. I think this is a very important point about being mainly an activist. You want to keep the movement going forward. It's not so much about promoting your own individual career or writing articles or writing books. It's that there's real issues that have to be fought. And if everybody's just screaming at each other, we can't mobilize behind those real issues. So I came up with the idea of the imaginary domain. Again, this also was around the right, which I call the right to abortion. And my argument of the imaginary domain is that each one of us is a sexual being. No matter how you organize your body or not, you have to do something with your sexual being. I use the word sexual very broadly because I didn't want to come down on the sex, gender, woman, non-woman side. And so that the most important thing about the imaginary domain, it's a moral, ethical, and I wanted it to be a legal right, so that it would actually allow people to have the moral, ethical, and psychoanalytic space to define and redefine how they wish to live with their sexual being. And the only limit on that was what I called the degradation prohibition, which is that, and I didn't use it in the flowery way that McKinnon used it, meaning that, you know, women are basically degraded in sex. McKinnon's had many different positions on this. She's not consistent, and maybe that's, you know, because nobody's consistent when it comes to sex, but at first it was just heterosexual sex was domination. then it was sort of, well, maybe there could be a heterosexual sex act that wasn't domination, and then maybe we all had to be lesbians, and then maybe we could have sex with men, but not intercourse. Anyway, it went through a whole series of configuration. What I wanted to say was that in the imaginary domain, we need the psychic and moral space. And that some in that psychic and moral space are going to identify as women, and some are not going to identify as women, and some are going to identify as transgender. And this would also ultimately also apply to language rights and to what was then called racial difference. Now, why did this matter? So, at the time that I wrote this book, gays and lesbians and transgender people were not seen as having standing to sue for sex or gender discrimination because it was an intra-class distinction. So, sex and gender discrimination by the early feminists was defined as you had to show a class of women that was discriminated against a class of men. So if two gay men sue, right, that is within the group of men. You have to show up with a group of women. So basically that meant that people couldn't sue for sex or gender discrimination. A lesbian's fired, she can't say she's fired for sex or gender, that it's an intra-class distinction. That was called formal equality. Now that dominated. It also has to do with McKinnon's path-breaking work on sexual harassment. Now, then the other problem was African-American women who braided their hair. They were seen as also just violating a dress code. It had nothing to do with their identity or their identification. And I said in the imaginary domain, if you identify as an African-American woman, and hair braiding is part of your identification, then you should be able to say that that's discrimination. So the imaginary domain actually has been used in Canada and South Africa around the issues. In South Africa at this point, marriage has been totally queered because first they said polygamy was okay, and then it was polyandry was okay. Then that's when supposedly women can have more than one husband, but you see most women who wanted polyandry wanted more than one woman because of ancestral wives. So the Constitutional Court decided that they didn't want to have anything to do with anything about anybody's marriage. So say your dead ancestor chooses this wife, and then you have a secular wife, and some people have sex, and some people, because of ancestor possession, sometimes have penises and sometimes they don't. It's just too complicated. So under the imaginary domain, they said if four people come to the civil court and say we want to get married, we're not going to ask any questions about who has a penis, a vagina, who's having sex, who's dead, who's alive. We're out. And so right now in South Africa, four women can walk in and say we're married. You get all the benefits of being married. And nobody asks any questions. So that's the idea of the imaginary domain, is to open the space for people to actually live their lives differently, including beyond couples. Now, and in order to do that, you have to really rethink the whole institution of monogamous marriage and what it means. And this happened slowly in South Africa, being the first country to recognize as a matter of dignity the marital rights of gays, lesbians, and the transgender. So, you know, what do you do with somebody who's in transition? Right? You don't have to have penises and vaginas anymore. You know, just poof. So that was the work the imaginary domain was meant to do in order to get over this debate about who's a woman, who isn't a woman, who's not a woman. Because what does it mean, really, to say to someone who identifies as an African-American woman, you're not a woman, because the category of woman doesn't exist in mathematically. I mean, really. So what if it doesn't exist in your philosophy? I mean, identification, identity are so complex. So what I ended up also doing is distinguishing between identity, identification, and position. Identifications are fluid. You're like McKinnon. You're a lesbian, you're a het, you're not het, you're a lesbian. You know, people go through many different transitions over their lives as they struggle to come to terms with whom they are. And identifications can be quite fluid. Identities, less so. We're born into a language. We're born and we're limited by our language. Wittgenstein, the limits of our language and the limits of our world. We're born into a family, we're born into a community, we're born into a religion. If I were to tell you that I am an African Zulu woman, you would rightfully tell me that I was psychotic. But if I went and lived in Zululand, raised my children in Zulu, stayed there, I would probably still never be considered Zulu, but my children would. So identity, although it's much less flexible, it's not 100% frozen either, but it's much less flexible. The idea that we're all everything is a fantasy, and it's a very dangerous political one. The last is position. This sounds very, obviously, since given my past, it sounds very 1970s. I believe there is such a thing called white skin privilege, and it's very real. And I will never, ever experience what it's like to be on the street as a black woman, certainly not as a black man, and I know that. And so position is really about understanding privilege and hierarchy. And you're the only white person in a consciousness-raising group. Part of what you have to understand and come to terms with is what it means for you to be white in that group. So I actually distinguish between identity, identification, and position. And this was my disagreement with Judith Butler in Excitable Speech, although I think it's a great book and learned it. In that certain forms of hate speech should be regulated. Again, in South Africa, this isn't a problem. There's certain contexts when you can't use certain words because of the way the Constitution is framed. There's no absolute First Amendment where everybody gets to say whatever they want, whenever they want, because all rights are limited by all other rights and primarily by dignity. So the imaginary domain, in a certain sense again, was to say we can't and do not need, at the level of philosophy, to resolve the issue of woman, non-woman, because it's a individual, personal, what we would call in law, subjective right. And it's not one that has to be resolved for all time. So we can stop screaming at each other about that. And then get down to the business of fighting, you know, which is always what was my goal. And this came up a lot in the round abortion, which is that a lot of women who imagined their fetus as being a baby were told that that would then get in the way of her right to abortion. But you see, not under the imaginary domain. That's perfectly consistent under the imaginary domain for me to donate, as I did, a woman who believes her 6 months fetus is a baby for heart surgery to save her baby. Because it's not a question about whether the fetus is primarily alive or not alive, or a person or not a person. From the standpoint of the person, the standpoint of law, a fetus is not a person. But from the standpoint of the woman, it's her imaginary domain. So you can, you don't have to get into these fraught debates about whether you can give money for heart surgery. Because if a woman imagines that fetus as a baby, then it's her imaginary domain that matters, not some kind of dogmatic position that you have to say abortion simply doesn't matter. It matters to some women. It doesn't matter to other women. It doesn't have anything to do with the right to abortion. I basically argue that women should have the right to abortion all the way through the cutting of the umbilical cord. It is non-comparative. It's not like any situation. It's not like a heart attack. It's not like being strung up to someone who's a great violinist. It's not like anything. Without it, a woman cannot imagine, those who imagine themselves as women, their own bodily integrity because their uterus is taken over and imagined by the state. And as I argue in this book, that starts way before you ever get pregnant. You know, in my generation, there was always Michelle would disappear for 9 months and come back. And we didn't have any sex education. One of my best friends would not dance with boys at dancing school because she heard that they sprayed something and that you could get pregnant from it. And so, you know, the whole idea was, you know, when you got your period, it was like, stay away from boys' periods. So she had just the view that boys should be on the other side of the room because of the spraying problem they have. And I explained what sprayed and what didn't spray, so she got a little afraid of that. So that begins long before what happens now. Today, there are 3 abortion clinics in New York City. They are under regular attack. Most, in 2 of them, women are treated literally like animals in the worst kind of animal slaughterhouse. They're lined up in chairs, they're knocked out. I worked in an abortion clinic for many years, so you do not have to have anesthesia in the first trimester of your pregnancy. It's very easy suction and it's very little pain. So why are we doing this? Because of the threats of the abortion lobby. You may live to see the right to abortion outlawed. And then we will go back to that very scary time that I'm describing. So this is a real battle for you. Under the imaginary domain, I said that what that does is it turns women into second-class citizenship because they no longer have any basic bodily integrity because of the assault on their imaginary domain. Now, I just want to get to the last part of this. And again, this idea of the imaginary domain was meant really to say that at the level of identification, you're going to find differences amongst people on the question of woman, non-woman. And you don't have to resolve them philosophically because they aren't theoretical disputes. They're disputes at the level of what we would call practical philosophy, and this was my practical philosophical argument. And the practical aspect of it really comes from being a lifelong activist. I always wanted to move the struggle forward. I still do. Now, in pornography, however, you have McKinnon saying, getting to the theme of your class, Carol, that all pornographic imagery in, again, at the time I was analyzing them, except for the gynecological stuff, I kind of need a who sadly is not with us anymore, Ona Z from a very different perspective. They made movies about sex and love. Candida Royale, almost entirely about lesbian love. Again, she was censored from the CD distribution because it was gynecology. Gynecology is when you show female yuck and there's no penises bouncing around the set. The industry's word for that is gynecology. And they didn't want to go to gynecologists because it was all yucky. So these men are all talking sexual freedom. As soon as you start looking at women, they don't want any sexual freedom. They find it offensive. They don't want to see it. Yucky. Should be censored. Ew. 80-year-old women having sex. You know. So their sexual liberatory voices became quite silent at that time. But that is not the mainstream industry, although I really would encourage you to look at some of the feminist pornography and think about what they were trying to do and what intervention they were trying to make. Ona Z, because she was always doing unions, always would have a little union pitch at the end of most of her movies, like, if this isn't all the time, what is, you know? So when you look at mainstream pornography, I know you've been meeting Freud through the con, so you'll understand some of this language, is that it's extremely violent. And the woman is the imagined object to be controlled, and control can take several different forms. And in the Lacanian story, which is the story that I tell in the chapter about the majority of imagery, you know, let's start with why pornography is only an ejaculation. That's already fairly phallic, right? I mean, we don't have to go much further than that. But in this scene, particularly where women are violently tied and controlled, and that's a great deal of the imagery, you could go all the way back to the Freudian Lacanian story. The greatest trauma, right, for the little boy, and we're going to talk about the little boy first because Freud doesn't talk very much about little girls. The little boy has to be separated from his first love object, the mother. And that separation is extremely violent, having to do with the loss of the breast. And there's now these movements that you just should keep breastfeeding as long as little boys want. So then they never have to lose the breast. They just go from one breast to another breast. But in the story that Freud tells and the con picks up on, you have to lose the breast. And when you lose the breast, that's a huge narcissistic wound. So you're like a little detective and you go on the road to finding that breast. And in the patriarchal story, what you find at the end is you find daddy. Now, the good news for the little boy is the little boy gets cut from mommy, he gets cut from the breast. This is why Lacan calls it symbolic castration. You can't go back to that breast, because daddy's going to get in the way of that. But the good, that's bad news. But the good news is that you can go forward and find your own breast. Because you, like daddy, have the penis, and that's what brings breasts about. Now, the figure of the woman who has everything, this is the fantasy of the phallic mother. This is, for Freud and for Lacan, fundamental, because this way, you can think that that breast is just going to stay with you. It's like the woman is complete in herself, so she doesn't have to go anywhere. She never has to leave you. She never has to go to work. She never has to go to daddy. She never has to go visit a friend. She never has to do anything. She's just for you. When the breast gets ripped away from you, then you realize that mommy isn't complete. And that figure of the non-completeness becomes threatening. Because this breast, it's the ultimate object of desire that has to be repressed in the unconscious, can always be taken from you again. That figure is a phallic mother. You see her over and over again in movies. You see her in cartoons. You see her, it's a movie called Fatal Attraction, where Glenn Close is stabbed 19 times and comes up out of the bathtub. That's the phallic mother. The phallic mother is the one suppressed now in the unconscious, who you once imagined as a woman complete in herself, but once suppressed in the unconscious, she becomes very scary. She's the one who gives life, who has, you know, what breasts are? It's a food. And that's a quote from Toni Morrison. Which literally can starve you out. And that figure in Freud and Lacan is the maternal body. So the maternal body is what has to be repressed in the unconscious. Now, as we've seen, the good news for the little boy is he can identify with daddy and ultimately have a safe breast. The problem is that the unconscious fantasy and the feminine as being both the ultimate desirable object and the objective other never goes away because it's repressed in the unconscious and it can't be symbolized. Now what you find in pornography is over and over again the dismemberment of women's bodies. And unfortunately, there were snuff sets at that time which literally dismember women's bodies. It also leads to sexual fetishization. A foot man, a hand man, a breast man, a toe man. And you actually will hear men speak about, I'm a breast man, or I'm actually a leg man, I'm a rear end man. That fetishization has to do with the way in which this repressed, scary, all-encompassing figure, it's got to be divided into parts, and those parts can be controlled. So even though the good news of a little boy is that he can get one of those, the repressed object in the unconscious, because it can't be symbolized, this is Lucia Riley's point, and it really becomes the objective underpinnings of all a civilization, of the civilization, of what we civilization. And that's why Freud was against socialism. He said, you don't have private property, men will just run around raping everyone. They didn't have a very rosy figure of men, because male violence is completely associated in Freud and in Lacan with this absolute terror of the feminine body. So this gives you a sense of what the scene was. There is no longer much of a porn industry. There's a little bit left where you actually go and are filmed, because almost all pornography has gravitated to the internet, both with real people and made-up people. So the industry structure has collapsed under that. But in the 90s, that wasn't the case. And so what you're grappling with is younger people, and it was almost entirely younger people. Elizabeth Wiggers won her last award at 51 prior to becoming a union organizer. Where people go and are filmed, and often in very exploitative conditions. And that's the scene, and of course people are actually having sex. The definition of pornography by the industry was that it had to be a male cum shot. In other words, you have to film an ejaculation. This is why, as we're going to see, the industry at that time found all of the feminist pornographers who just had women having sex with each other, they called those gynecology. Nobody has any interest in a bunch of women fiddling around. That wasn't pornography. What's serious about pornography is when you have a penis, you know, the dun, 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 dun. So you can have all the women naked in the world, and that's not pornography, according to the porn industry at that time. Without the ejaculation, it's gynecology. Catherine McKinnon argued that there, basically the porn industry should be shut down through the use of legal mechanisms. The legal mechanisms were that porn workers could bring civil lawsuits for harm and get damages for all sorts of things. Of course, she also thought that pornography, like prostitution, should be criminalized. Now, there's a problem with criminalization, and I should say a little bit about myself in this. I've been involved in the prostitutes organization movement most of my life. When I was first a union organizer in New York City, I was involved in a consciousness-raising group where I was the only white woman in the South Bronx, where there were two women who worked as prostitutes. Both of them had had mothers who died in their 40s of brown lung working in doll factories. This again, the United States actually used to produce things. This is dates this story. We used to have doll factories as well as printing presses. Soho was nothing but the biggest printing industry in the United States, believe it or not. All gone now. Anyway, they just chose to become prostitutes as a result of this. And we got involved as early 1970s now in the idea of decriminalization and unionization for prostitutes. We were very young, and we also decided to organize a collective brothel. The brothel was to share all profits, and all sex acts were to be checked off, and there were to be enforcement that no one got out of control. As part of this, this is perhaps the funny part of the story, we developed a safe sex machine so that one of the women in our group was taking classes in engineering. All right, she didn't have a degree and she wasn't very experienced, but we thought we could handle it anyway. The idea of the machine was that every male would go through the machine, and it was built on the model of a car wash. We thought we would patent the machine, make millions of dollars, and then have money for our collective brothels that we were going to build throughout the city. It was built by women, and we realized that there were certain kinks in it. We didn't take into account size on any level. The idea was you went through the machine, it was not automated, you had to pull yourself through the machine, and at the end, a condom was shot on. This was to guarantee safe sex. We're in our early 20s, we thought this was pure genius.
Did it work on anything?
Actually, it was. Maybe we just made up
that. Did it work on anything? You said that it wasn't... You said you didn't consider size or any different kind of man, but did it work on anyone besides, because everyone has a different height, I mean, you know,
you went through this wash, and at the end, we did have different condom sizes, so then there would be a condom shot onto the male organ, and then the man was cleared to go into the brothel, this therefore guaranteeing safe sex. This is before AIDS, but there's a lot of sexually transmitted diseases.
But everyone has a different height. Like, I'm 6 foot, and the guy behind me could be like 5'6".
Well, we could do minor adjustments to that.
Yeah.
That's because you could frame the entire machine. And remember, you're going to pull yourself through it. That wasn't the main problem.
Oh, okay. What was the main problem?
And it was like a car wash, so you went through all the different aspects. And then you got your condom on. The problem is that we just had a lot of kinks in the machinery. So sometimes people got caught in the soaping stage. And sometimes people got caught in the rinsing stage. Perhaps because of domination, this machine did not cause as much grief as one might have expected, although it caused a certain amount of grief. Because of this involvement, our group, and what happened to this brothel, is we were unable to defeat the pimps. The pimps made deals with the police. Many of the people involved were involved in the Black Panthers and the Young Lords. We all could shoot guns, and we did armed self-defense of our brothel. However, we just couldn't defeat the police. So we lasted about 10 months. Now this gives you a sense of both the strengths of unionization and the problems of unionization in a sphere of life that's governed by drugs and by pimps and by crooked police. However, in the 70s, the idea was criminalization of prostitution, and we held on to our program of unionization because to treat prostitutes as if they were somehow or another that different than the rest of us, just poor victims, was in a sense to further disempower them. I still hold to that position, and I held to it in the 90s. So in other words, I carry this whole experience forward with me. Catherine McKinnon's idea of a civil lawsuit, which would bring down the porn industry, right? If every porn worker brings a lawsuit for civil harm and sues for damages, you can't keep a porn site open because you're going to be suing all the time. She was a lawyer, needless to say. On the other side were the First Amendment people, who said that pornography is speech, and therefore should be protected as speech. Now, McKinnon's argument was that it's not speech. What it is a coercive speech act. For instance, like if you walked by a restaurant that said, whites only come in here, that isn't just speech, it's actually performing an exclusion. So for her, pornography was a coercive speech act, something close to screaming fire in a movie theater. And therefore, in that sense, it should have no First Amendment protection, and you should be able to proceed with the civil lawsuit. This is an important part, I think, for younger women to know about. It just completely split the feminist movement. And it was, all sorts of articles in the newspaper. You obviously know some people who are involved in this. Feminists hate each other. Feminists can't get along. Isn't this the way women always are? All they do is get on panels and scream at each other. And that's what panels were like. If you've ever met Catherine McKinnon, she's ferocious. It would be this horrific screaming matches with the press saying, this is the way women treat each other. I was very reluctant to get involved on either side. And this is, takes me back to my history. The first thing I decided to do was go to the ground. And I figured there's got to be some women out there organizing. And I'm going to go talk to those women about what they would like us to do who are outside the industry. And so I was, of course, told that there were no union organizers in the industry. And without the internet, it took me exactly 8 hours to find Ona Z. Weegers. And Ona Z. had begun a union campaign in 1992. Her main campaign was all safe sex. And when you organize a union, it's always good to have a campaign. So she knew that, and remember, she's a superstar. It's like having Meryl Streep be your union organizer. That meant that every set had to have condoms. Well, you see our problem immediately. If pornography is a film male ejaculation, what happens when you put a condom on the male organ? Gynecology, bunch of women fiddling around, nothing exciting to see. So the porn industry said that all condom sets were a violation of their First Amendment rights to have pornography. And as he said, she didn't much care. Because what was happening now in the 90s is that young people in the porn industry were dying of AIDS at very high numbers. So what would Ona Z. do? Well, she did what unions do. She'd get a big piece of wood with a tiny sign and bang through the windows and rescue people who were having sex without condoms. She hated feminists. When I first reached her, I said I was a law professor and a feminist, and she hung up on me. I called her back and said, I also ran a collective brothel, and I know how to shoot. we can talk. And the reason for her fury, and this gets to the question, because I'm separating out the organizational scene from the images of domination and pornography, and whether it's a coercive speech up, is because oftentimes feminists who are in the academy, feminists who are middle class, feminists who are white, really don't get what's going on in the street. And so when Ona Z. had the reason she hated feminists is, right, all these women in the academy are writing articles for the Harvard Law Review. She's got over 400 people signed up for her union, building it out of scratch. Of course, the pornography industry is very associated with the mafia. She's enduring death threats. She has all sorts of threats on her life on a daily basis. She wants feminists to put their money where their mouth is and get there on the picket lines and blast through those windows and drag young people out who are being forced to have unsafe sex. That's what she wants. Then if you're not serious about doing that, you're not serious about doing anything about the porn industry. You're just building your goddamn career on the backs of porn workers. Now, I went out to Los Angeles and I showed her that I would pay my dues. I helped close down 3 porn sets. I mean, as an old union organizer, I know the big piece of wood, little sign strategy, which is that you use the wood to break the windows and you climb in and you drag people up. And what do you do with the wood? You go after them. And if necessary, owners oftentimes carry guns, you pack a gun, and when people come after you, you hold a gun to their head and say these young people are leaving. Union organizing has never been a peaceful setting.
Wouldn't you be arrested for this?
Pardon?
Wouldn't you get arrested for breaking and entering? Private.
Of course they tried to get you for breaking and entering. But pornography, because it's a form of prostitution, is basically illegal. So yeah, sure, they tried to get you for breaking and entering, and then we said, this is a porn site where young workers are being held as slaves. So, you know, pornography's never been legal in this country. Prostitution is not legal. And of course, there's a very strong argument that just because you're photographing people doesn't make it not prostitution. So you got a little bit of a leg up, so to speak, because you can break and enter into an illegal workplace without the police, unless the police are completely corrupt. And in this case in Los Angeles, a lot of the police just wanted to stay out of this because it was getting increasingly ugly. Of course it was breaking and entering. But into an illegal place that shouldn't exist. Now, that union was enormously successful. However, what happened then is Ona Z, when she wasn't being threatened, got sued by the pornography industry for violating, not for breaking and entering, which because they couldn't really do it, but for violating their First Amendment rights. Because they had the right to do films with an ejaculation. But this First Amendment lawsuit did not get very far. Not surprisingly, because nobody wanted to touch that either. So this is really the scene in which I entered the debate. There are quotes from the interviews I did with Ona Z, and I actually conducted about 3 days of interviews with her. And what was Ona Z's position on pornography and prostitution? Did she think it was liberatory? No, not at all. She said something, to use her words, something goes kaflooey with young people who go into prostitution or into pornography. It's not like she had a view that this was a sexual, liberatory way of engaging, which some now postmodern, so-called postmodern Foucauldians are arguing in a complete misinterpretation of Foucault that, you know, this is just the most liberatory form of sex. What she said in her own life was that she had been raped by her grandfather when she was 4, and getting money back was a way of symbolic compensation for what had been taken from her for free. It was a stage of her recovery and healing, and therefore she did not believe that in any way she should be treated as a victim, someone without agency, but instead someone who had to go through a series of complicated stages in her life in order to get to where she ended up. Omazee's now a sex therapist. She slowly got out of the industry, first by union organizing, and then by becoming, this is a way to sex therapy, by becoming a feminist pornographer, and then doing a whole series of sex education films. One of her spoofs on the porn industry is called Sex Academy, which talks about how anyone can be a porn star, and also makes her argument for double time during that time of the month. And what she did was she lays down and shows what a woman has to wear at that time of the month in order to have sex in the porn industry, and argues that this isn't double time, what is. Now what happened, remember there's CD stores where you go buy your porn CDs? Omazee was censored. So Omazee, because of now censorship, sued the porn industry for getting infringing on her First Amendment rights to make porn. Well, at first they said it wasn't porn. Well, she said, if you define porn only as male ejaculation, it isn't, but this is pornography if you define it a little more widely. So all of this is going on at the time that the feminists in the academy are arguing. Omazee's union was eventually defeated. It lasted for about 3 years, and part of the defeat was you can't affiliate with the AFL-CIO, the big union organization, if you're organizing an illegal workplace. So decriminalization and unionization, or organization, always have to go together. McKinnon's view of the prostitute can't comprehend a woman like Omazee Weigers. And this is very important because she obviously is a person of tremendous force and agency. To view her as a passive victim would be to completely miss who she is. She also rescued hundreds of people. And as she put it very simply, would you rather have a couple of girls, her word, come in, get you out of the workplace, or would you rather have AIDS die and sue and leave a little money to your children? For her, that was an easy choice. You want a couple of girls coming in and taking you out so you don't die of AIDS. And what's such a good thing about a lawsuit once you're dying or dead? So the first thing I did in intervening in pornography
to introduce you. Drucilla Cornell is professor of political science, women and gender studies, and comparative literature at Rutgers University. But she's not only that, she's been a union organizer for a number of years before joining academia. She's been a lifelong activist. She's a playwright. To put it in a word, for me, this is what it means to be a woman. I'll give an example of how rich and thrilling in being a woman can be. She's been inhabiting all of the spaces that are typically associated with masculine power, the law, philosophy, academia, universities, and reshaping all of them with her presence. So I'm glad she exists in the first place, and I'm really thrilled that we'll be discussing today with her. Please join me in welcoming Drucilla.
I thought I would do three things today. The first is that I would situate the debate in pornography at the time I wrote this book, which came out in 1995. So it's a long time ago now. And it's really before the internet, before iPhones. And within that context, talk about the way in which feminists got involved in this really ferocious debate, which significantly divided the feminist movement, particularly in the academy at that time. And then talk a little bit about, I know you've been reading a lot of psychoanalytic literature, pornographic images are. That part probably hasn't changed as dramatically as was the scene that I am. So first let me just tell you about the pornography industry. In 1990, early 1990s, when I tried to figure out what my position was on sites where people went and were filmed, and they made these things called CDs. They had an award ceremony, they had an organization, and the woman that you're going to hear about, Ona Z. Weavers, was like the Meryl Streep of the porn industry. She won over 11 awards as best porn actress. She's also one of the longest-lived